Hi, are you making a Game Boy emulator and want some help getting started or something? If you're completely new to this, and you haven't already, you might want to check out my other video about getting started, where I talk about machine code and CPU registers and reading a ROM file. You don't have to, though. You can start here if you want. I'm hoping this video will help you get started with the rest of the stuff related to emulating a Game Boy, specifically the graphics. We'll get to the rest in another video. This isn't a detailed step-by-step type guide, though, and I'm going to be leaving a bunch of things out. My hope is to give you some high-level guidance and leave most of the figuring out and learning to you. Also, I'm kind of speaking out of my ass here. I've never actually made a Game Boy emulator, and I'm not planning to. I'm nowhere near the most knowledgeable person about this stuff, which is to say, feel free to ignore me. I do have some credentials, though. I've been a professional software developer for a good while, and I've been tinkering with Game Boys since 2020. It's weird how a bunch of hobbies started that year. So hopefully I'm not wasting your time. If you want to learn from people who do know what they're doing and won't waste your time, like say an award-winning team of teachers, researchers, and professionals from Stanford, MIT, Caltech, Microsoft, Google, and more, then you should check out Brilliant, the sponsor of this video. If you've watched some of my other videos, you'll know that I like learning while doing. I also like having a chance to play with the things that I'm learning about. That's what makes Brilliant so interesting. Each lesson is filled with hands-on problem solving and demos that you can play with to help you engage with and understand the topic more fully. If you've never programmed before and the idea of making a Game Boy emulator seems completely out of reach, then Brilliant's Thinking in Code course is a great place to start. By introducing you to the core ideas of programming and giving you problems to play with, it'll help you get used to the kind of structured reasoning that's used when programming. And that's just a start. To learn for free on Brilliant, go to brilliant.org/systemoflevers, scan the QR code on screen, or click on the link in the description. Brilliant will also give you 20% off an annual premium subscription, which gives you unlimited daily access to everything on Brilliant. Okay, let's jump right in. The Game Boy graphic system can produce mind-boggling effects, and your emulator is going to have to reproduce them. Joking aside, the Game Boy's graphic system is actually really cool. In fact, I've been making a series of videos talking about how Game Boy graphics work. The main theme of how Game Boy graphics work is to get as much visual oomph for as little CPU usage as possible. The Game Boy CPU is not fast, so anything that takes a load off of it is helpful. The Game Boy's graphics are tile-based. One part of video RAM stores all the tile data, and another says where those tiles go. There are two tile map-based layers, the background and the window, each with their own quirks, and a layer for sprites called the object layer. They all get composited together to make what's shown on screen. The thing doing this compositing, and actually getting pixels on screen, is called the Pixel Processing Unit, or PPU. One property of the Game Boy's architecture is that the PPU and the CPU can't both be accessing the video RAM at the same time. That's why if you open up an original Game Boy, you see two memory chips. One is the video RAM, the other is the work RAM. In the Game Boy Pocket in color, the video RAM is actually integrated into the main chip. Even though the Game Boy has an LCD display, its rendering routine is inspired by analog CRT signals. A CRT draws its picture one line at a time by scanning an electron beam across one line of the screen. Honestly, I find this way cooler than LCD or OLED displays. When it gets to the end of the line, the CRT beam needs to be aimed back to the start of the next line. Because of physics reasons, it takes time to bring the beam back to the start. This gives a bit of time where the CRT isn't actually drawing anything. That time is called the horizontal blanking interval, or HBlank. When it finishes the last line, the beam needs to be aimed back to the start of the first line. And again, this takes time. Time where the CRT beam isn't drawing anything. The Game Boy does essentially the same thing with its LCD. It updates the screen, pixel by pixel, line by line. At the end of the line, the Game Boy could go straight to the start of the next line, since there's no electromagnetical physics getting in the way. But it doesn't. it pauses for a bit to give a bit of HBlank time. Same thing when it gets to the end of the screen. It pauses a bit to give some VBlank time. The reason it's done like this is to give a game the chance to update video RAM. The PPU isn't accessing video RAM during HBlank and VBlank, so the CPU can make updates. That's all to say that your emulator can't just render the screen all at once. Games will use the HBlank time to update graphics in the middle of the screen being drawn. This lets them achieve certain effects. For example, EG Room's Outrun Game Boy demo creates curved roads by changing the background scroll X at various lines during HBlank. If you want to check it out, I have a link in the description. So, your emulator is going to have to reproduce the HBlank and VBlank time. In the documentation, HBlank is also called Mode 0, and VBlank is called Mode 1. There's also Mode 2, which is OAM search. OAM search happens just before the start of a line, and most of video RAM is accessible by the CPU, except object attribute memory. Mode 3 is the last mode. It's where the line is actually being drawn, and where video RAM and OAM can't be accessed by the CPU at all. The graphics system also has a bunch of I/O registers to control it. These control things like turning the display on and off, turning layers on and off, moving layers around, changing the color palettes, and various other things. There's a lot about the Game Boy's graphics system that I didn't mention, and a bunch more details about the things I did mention, like that Mode 0 and Mode 3 can vary in length depending on what's being drawn on the screen, a trick that wouldn't be possible on a home console with a CRT. You can find far more details about the rendering in the Pandox rendering section, in particular, the Pixel FIFO page. In my opinion, Pixel FIFO is the most complicated part of the Game Boy, and I haven't gotten around to fully wrapping my head around it. My recommendation is to ignore it as you're getting started. There's a lot of nuanced behavior that's not crucial for getting basic graphics to render. There are, of course, some games that rely on those details, and if you want to be perfectly frame accurate, you'll have to deal with them at some point. I just don't think that point is right at the start. My recommendation for implementing the graphics system is to split the work into the following milestones. Skip to here if you don't want me telling you how to live your life. I have to warn you, though, the plan that I'm about to suggest may leave you with a graphics system that won't integrate super obviously into the rest of your emulator. I'm going to have you ignore what I just said, that your emulator can't just render the screen all at once. In fact, I'm kinda suggesting you start off by treating the graphics system as a totally separate project. That's because the graphics system is pretty big and fairly complicated. The first milestone is to render a single tile map in a single pass. Don't worry about rendering modes, scrolling, palettes, or any other rendering options. You can either render the full 32x32 tiles of the tile map, or just the top left 160x144 pixel slice that would be displayed on the screen. This will be the foundation of the background layer. It will get you started handling the tile's binary format and converting a tile map into pixels. Next, you can add the palette so that you can change colors around. The third milestone is to introduce the option to change which tile map and which set of tiles are used to render the background. Now, I'd suggest adding scrolling to the background. Depending on how you've implemented things so far, this should be a pretty big change, so it should be fun. That gets background rendering roughly done-ish, so it's a good time to start adding more layers by tackling the window layer. It's kind of similar to the background layer. And with the window layer done, you can move on to implementing objects, or sprites. If you got all that done and working, congratulations! You now have a reasonable approximation of the Game Boy's rendering system. This is actually what I built to make my Game Boy graphics videos. If you want to test it out, I've prepared a few tile maps and tile data sets for you to test with. I've linked them in the description. At this point, it's time to tackle per-line rendering. This is where you might discover that I've given you absolutely terrible advice up to this point. That's because I did. Really, just the worst advice. Going from rendering the screen all at once to the much more articulated behavior of the actual Game Boy and integrating with the rest of the emulator is a huge change. You might have to throw out all the rendering stuff you've built up to this point because I've led you down the wrong path. If you're in that situation, sorry. If you do have to throw some, or everything out, don't worry. You're not an abject failure. This subproject wasn't necessarily meant to get you to the final product. It was meant to build your understanding and comfort with the Game Boy's graphic system, to give you the knowledge and context to help you make decisions when implementing the real thing. Think of it like a sketch. It lets you get the ideas out of your head, to see what's working from a design perspective, and what's not. Now you can tighten things up and start laying down the final lines. If you do plan on throwing everything out from the start, it also lets you be sloppy with how you code it the first time. Don't worry about efficiency or readability. Take every shortcut you can to get something working, so you can learn what you need to without getting stuck. Just be sure to actually throw out the crappy code you wrote. You can also plan ahead instead. Decide how exactly you want the graphic system to fit into everything, and build the subproject with that in mind. The planning can be fun in and of itself. Plus, it's an important skill to practice. If you're lucky, your plan will be totally wrong, and you'll have the chance to develop more intuition for future planning. I'm going to warn you though, per-line rendering probably makes most sense to implement only once you have machine code evaluation working. So if you want some help doing that, check out my other video. To get everything really working, you'll also need to have your memory system working, and a handle on clock timing. I should have a video about that at some point. When I do, I'll add a link somewhere. I hope you're having fun. Bye!